Hello, hello everyone. How are you? This is Nour Zibdeh, and the first few times we talked about the gut, why it's important, leaky gut, and how do you know that you have it. Today is about acid reflux, heartburn, and GERD. So I'm gonna get started with this. If you are just joining, this is Nour Zibdeh. I am a functional dietitian and nutritionist, and I help people fix their guts, and I help them fix their bodies from the inside out so that they have energy for the people that they care most about, to do the things that they love, and to feel comfortable in their own bodies. So we're gonna get started in today's episode on acid reflux, heartburn, GERD in the show Thank God It's Fixed. So what I do have some notes that I am just making sure that I am covering the topic. This is a topic that I am super passionate about, and I promise you're going to learn something new, and there are some things that very different than what you the common medical approach or to dealing with acid reflux. And so you might be surprised with some things. There will be some medical terms. I will do my best to keep things simple, but it's really hard to talk about it without including medical terms. So I'm gonna have some pictures for you. So heartburn is having that burning sensation under the breastbone. So just right under your rib cage or on top of the stomach. That burning, that warm feeling or sensation. Acid reflux is when the acid, or actually not just the acid, it's the stomach content, refluxes up or travels up from the stomach to the esophagus. Esophagus, think of it as the food tube that is connecting your throat and mouth to the stomach. And so reflux is when the content of the stomach wash or refluxes back up or splashes up to the esophagus, and that can cause the pain, irritation, painful sensation, maybe sour taste in your mouth. But what people don't know, and this is very interesting, that acid reflux can be related to symptoms that are not just the burning on top of the top part of the stomach. Acid reflux can be is actually the cause for things like feeling a lump in your throat or that you cannot swallow. Coughing, if you are constantly coughing and it's not an infection and it can't you don't seem to have bacterial infection, that can be reflux. Hoarseness in your voice, that is acid reflux. And acid can actually go to your lungs and cause asthma or pneumonia. So the acid reflux is the process by the content of the stomach goes up. Heartburn is the warm sensation under the rib cage. And GERD, or GERD, which is gastroesophageal reflux disease. This is what happens when acid reflux happens more frequently. So if it's mild and it happens two or more times a week, then you go to the doctor, they give you that label that you have GERD. Or if it's severe and it happens once a week, then you have that's GERD. Now there's another condition that I want to mention. It is called LPR. What that means, it's laryngopharyngeal reflux. So I just want to show you a little bit of picture here. If you look at the back of your throat, that's your pharynx. Your larynx is right here, which is Adam's apple. So LPR is another condition that is caused by the acid coming from the stomach all the way to here. And these are the symptoms with coughing, hoarseness in the voice, and inability to swallow. Like you feel like food is getting stuck in here. And typically, this is something that most people don't connect to the stomach because some people have LPR without having the stomach pain or the heartburn, so they don't connect it. And you might go to your ENT or ear, nose, and throat, and they would work on this, and your gastroenterologist will look on the bottom, even though it's one system that is messed up, that there's a problem in that system. But this is how conventional medicine is. Different parts of the body are managed by different kinds of doctors without really looking at the root cause. Why is treating acid reflux important? You might think that, you know what, look, whatever, I can just take Tums or recline after eating, not lay down, and just be fine. Or the acid is not really that painful, doesn't really matter. And it's not just the discomfort. The problem with acid reflux is that there are long-term side effects, the irritation and the scarring that can happen to the esophagus. Long-term, the lining, if this is not treated, the lining of the esophagus starts to resemble the lining of your intestine because there are enzymes and things in there that are not supposed to be there. What that causes precancerous cells from developing, and it causes them to develop, and that's called Barrett's esophagus. And then the doctor would know this through an endoscopy. And then that could lead to esophageal cancer, which is one of the very difficult to deal with cancers. So we want to do anything in our hands, in our control, to prevent any type of cancer, of course. Now, even though it's a small risk, but we want to prevent that. If the acid is staying here in your mouth, now the saliva will become acidic and your teeth are going to get eroded. You're going to be more likely to develop periodontal disease. I don't know about you, but I like to keep my teeth without pain and looking good. And so the long-term damage of acid that's not treated can be painful, can be very serious. Acid reflux, the name is misleading because you think that it's acid that's the problem, but it's not really acid. It's not hydrochloric acid. So to give you a little bit of background about digestion. So if you remember, here's your digestive system, and here's your stomach, and in your stomach, you are going to produce enzymes to help break down the food. If you look at the esophagus, the food tube, and the stomach, they are connected by a muscle. It's actually not one muscle, it's a group of muscles that are called LES, which is the lower esophageal sphincter. And so these muscles, what they're supposed to do is they're supposed to open up when food is coming down. So they let food into the stomach and then they close so that the stomach will do its thing, digest food and process that. And then actually there's another muscle that's connecting your stomach to your intestine, and that's what's going to open up to let the food go. Now, what happens is it's that the muscles open up. This muscle or group of muscles down here, they're going to open up, and the content of the stomach is going to go up, cause the problem. So the content of the stomach is not just acid. Most people think that it's just hydrochloric acid. What's in the stomach is actually, there's an enzyme called pepsin that is released by the lining of the stomach, and it's released or secreted inactive. And when the food shows up, the body will sense that, and the cells will produce hydrochloric acid, and the hydrochloric acid will activate the pepsin. So it starts to break down the chemical bonds between amino acids and to break down protein. And then in the stomach, there are also bile acids that are going to help with the digestion. So it's not hydrochloric acid that's by itself the problem. It is all of the stomach content. And the medical, the common solution to acid reflux is, this is the thought process. You have heartburn or acid reflux, that means you have too much acid, so we're going to treat it by reducing the acids or acid or preventing it or stopping it. And, you know, most people, what they do is, you know, if it's something that's new or if it's not very severe, they pop Tums, which are calcium salts, and they neutralize the acid. So if you remember from basic chemistry, acid plus base equals water and carbon dioxide. So it neutralizes the acid, and then you burp, that's the carbon dioxide. Now, if things get worse, or if it happens too often, and now you start to think, oh, let me go grab over-the-counter Nexium or Pepcid or one of those medications. Now this becomes scary and serious, because even though this is a smaller dose of a prescription medication, people are overusing it and for long period of times, and they have serious side effects. So you're not, and then you're not really solving the problem. If you go to your doctor, there are two types of medications that they would recommend: something called H2 antagonist, which suppresses acid, or PPI, which is a proton pump inhibitor, and it's another medication that's stronger that suppresses the acid. So H2 antagonist, something like Zantac or Pepcid. PPI, things like Nexium, Prilosec, Protonix, Omeprazole, Pantoprazole kind of medications, so depending on if you go by the generic or the brand name. So here's what I always tell people. It's not that you have too much acid. It's not that you have too much hydrochloric acid. The problem is stomach content, whether it's too much or too little. It doesn't matter with the acid, it's just the stomach content where it should stay in the stomach that is protected, that there's a mucus that the stomach cell can handle this acid. Now it's going up to a place that doesn't tolerate it. They're not welcome in the esophagus. And now we're starting to have the irritation and the problems. Why do doctors keep recommending PPIs or medications? Is that they work, they cover up the symptom. They are a band-aid solution. Some people go to their doctors asking for a medication, like they're begging for a prescription. So I know that you're in pain, but this doesn't solve the problem. It's a short-term solution. And if you have been following me for enough time, you know that I'm not about quick fixes. I want to get to the root of the problem, and we want to fix that so that you don't have to deal with this for the rest of your life. I don't know about you, but I want to eat oranges and pineapple and berries and strawberries and tomatoes because all these foods are considered acidic. If you look at the acidic value or like how much acid in those, it is considered acidic. And what that will do is that will cause the burning sensation. Now, what I forgot to say is that the pepsid, which is the enzyme that's supposed to be in the stomach, now they start to find it in the esophagus for people who have heartburn and reflux. And what happens with that is anytime you eat an acidic food, this enzyme gets activated. So as you're swallowing, it gets activated and you feel the burning sensation. If you've tried to have raw apple cider vinegar, because you hear it's good for digestion, people who have acid reflux, most of the time they say it burns. It does not feel good. So we want to get rid of that pepsid in the esophagus where it's not there. Get rid of it so we can tolerate these foods and enjoy them because they're good for you and they're delicious. So the problem is that the muscle that's separating the esophagus and the stomach is opening up. And when that is opening up, it is causing the content of the stomach to go up. Now, there are claims that there are certain foods that make that muscle relax, things like coffee and chocolate. But another thought is that, wait, why is this muscle relaxing? It's not supposed to relax. And it's not about the acid, because I believe that we're created in a way to be, the human body is created in a way to be functioning perfectly. So our creator wouldn't have put acid in our bodies if it wasn't useful. And it's actually very important. If you don't have enough acid in the stomach, you will not be able to absorb iron or zinc or selenium or B12. So you're going to have mineral deficiencies. You're going to have protein or amino acids. You're not going to be able to break down protein properly. If you don't have enough acid in the stomach, this will be a very lovely place for bacteria to grow because it's not acidic anymore. It's not sterile anymore. And this bacteria is going to ferment and eat up any food that you eat. And as the bacteria ferments the food that you eat, it's going to cause gases to produce. And that fermentation, the pressure, will cause the muscles to open up and release the stomach content. So the real true cause of acid reflux is not too much acid. It's actually fermentation and the pressure from the stomach to up. And when we take PPI medications or H2 antagonist medications, and we suppress the acid, then we suppress digestion, and then we make fermentation worse, and we have things refluxing up to the esophagus. So I had a question about natural solutions. And you might have seen recommendations for apple cider vinegar to try, but the problem, even though it helps digestion, it can actually cause irritation if your stomach isn't or hasn't healed. So apple cider vinegar may not be the best solution if you already have heartburn. Now, the quick solution, band-aid solution, food-wise, is to avoid the food that are acidic. So that is something I have my patients do, because we kind of have to cross that gap or bridge to so that there's no more reflux or that the content is not getting pushed up. So, and then when we fix that, then we can bring acidic foods back in. So things like berries and tomatoes and pineapple, coffee, sometimes chocolate, mint, these are things that you want to avoid. I want to talk about more about, you know, other natural remedies, but what really is, before we try to fix and repair, we have to eliminate the root cause of the problem. Remove some of the foods that cause fermentation in the stomach. So things like garlic and onion and wheat products. So yeah, some try taking out the breads, actually all carbohydrates, breads and pastas and even like beans and oats, even though they're, some of them are healthy, have fiber, that can cause more fermentation and that will make the heartburn worse. 30 grams of carbohydrates can make you produce 3 gallons of gas. So think of 3 gallons of milk filled with gas, and they are being produced in your intestine and your stomach. That's enough gas to push the stomach content up and create problems. So I hope this gave you just an idea of the root cause of acid reflux and how to, you know, think about it. Most people or most doctors think of just of the stomach, where you really have to, or the esophagus, you really have to think down in the digestion and deeper in the gut of all the fermentation that is happening and what is really being digested properly and what's not being digested properly. So your trial, if you want to give something a try, is to take out garlic and onion for a week. They tend to cause more fermentation. Take out, wheat and gluten, but not just the wheat. It's in general, cut back on your carbohydrates, cut back on your sugars. That's obvious, right? Like all of the different kinds of sugars that are in your food, the sweets, the baked goods, these are all like quick food for bacteria in your gut that is going to cause fermentation. So if you have any questions, leave them in the comments section. I will take a look at them and I will answer them. And if I have enough questions to do another episode on acid reflux and heartburn, I will. So if you're watching this and you're like, okay, I have heartburn, what do I do? And it's not very easy to give a general recommendation. So try some of the tips that I have shared. But if you want more, you can always reach out to me. I'm in Virginia, but I help people all across the country. So you can reach out to me, schedule a free consultation where, you know, I see what your problem is. And if there's some things that I feel I can help you with, I will definitely share that with you. What I really didn't get into is all the infections and things that can be happening down in the gut, which can be causing heartburn, which is going to be a lot longer than this in more detail. So it's something that I'll definitely be talking about next time. I will be back next week and I will be checking my messages or the comments on this thread. Have a great day, and I hope it wasn't too complicated. Talk to you later. Bye.